Return of the Living Dead proved its namesake when a second sequel was dreamed up 5 years after Part 2, a film deemed lackluster in the eyes of fans, critics, and the box office. Hoping for the best, a fresh team was brought in to breathe new life into the undead.
I went on to do another small movie, actually, which was a comedy movie as well. So I chose not to do it, essentially.
When I got involved with Return of the Living Dead 3, I had already been making movies for a little while. I was a huge fan of Dan O'Bannon's Return of the Living Dead, and I really loved Night of the Living Dead, and I knew that Return of the Living Dead was kind of this unofficial kind of sequel to Night of the Living Dead, because it basically took the title, but Dan did what he did something else with it. He made a kind of a EC Comics movie.
I clearly had seen Return of the Living Dead because I ended up marrying a young actress who had a role in that film. Some of you may know who she is. She's Linnea Quigley. She played Trash. And so, yes, I saw her infamous tombstone dance, and I said, you know what? I gotta get me some of that.
I wasn't daunted, I think, by the idea of doing a sequel to Return of the Living Dead. The second one took the humor from the first one, and it was more slapstick. It really was concentrating on the comedy, and after that one, I didn't know what else you could do in that vein.
Over the course of the first and second film, Kenny Myers and I developed a pretty close friendship with Tom Fox, the executive producer of the films. And at some point at a dinner or a lunch that Kenny and I had with Tom, he mentioned that they were going to be doing a part three and asked us if we had any story ideas, because they didn't have a script for it yet.
We brought in writers to pitch takes on it. And I forget how many writers we saw, but it must have been at least a half dozen or 10 who came up with their idea for a sequel.
Brian and I did a treatment based around the origins of trioxin, because Brian and I felt logically that no one ever explained that properly. And we thought we had a really good idea. It got us a meeting.
And so I walked in there, and I remember sitting on a couch, and there was like three or four guys, and they looked at me and they just said, "So, tell us about this movie." And I was like, well, didn't you read the treatment? I didn't realize I was supposed to now do some like exciting presentation on my vision for the film and our vision for the script.
This is one of the classic places where people really didn't understand the genre they were about to shoot.
The consequence of that was is that they obviously did not go with our idea. But I have to say the script that John Penny ended up writing did end up going in some of the same directions.
Return of the Living Dead 3 came to me as a phone call from my agent. You know, they're doing part 3 of Return of the Living Dead, and they need pitches, and would you go in and pitch an idea for Return of the Living Dead 3? And I said, wow, you know, why not try an idea where you're dealing with sort of a Romeo and Juliet situation with a person who it's too difficult for him to let go of the person he loves. And so even though she was dead, that he was going to try to hold on to her.
When I heard John Penny's, that one really, really clicked with me, and I liked him. And so we went with him.
My father had just recently passed away, and I was dealing with that a lot, about that idea of letting go of somebody that you really love.
And so then we developed the script from that basis.
What I did is really try to pull some through lines from the original, with obviously the trioxin and all the other sort of basic rules and ideas from the first one. But Brian really liberated us and said, okay, that's fine. Yes, it is a sequel, but let's try to do something different, and let's not feel that we're somehow shackled by remaking the first two.
What Brian and John did was to take it a little bit more seriously with very little money. You know, and I hate to compare a zombie movie to Shakespeare, but this is very Shakespearean, because at the end of the film, it's a tragic love story. It really is.
The whole pattern was based on that sort of desperate, doomed love affair that they carried, you know, holding on to each other as everything around them was falling apart and deteriorating.
It was that love affair and the ability to bring it to life, even after death, that was a major factor in the film's casting.
We saw quite a few people for the main roles. We needed to have a Kurt and Julie that fit together. They had to have some chemistry, look good together.
Kurt Reynolds, 17, cruises into the parking lot on a brand new Honda motorcycle. He's got an open, honest, boyish, handsome face. When I was a teenager, I worked in a movie theater. And I actually got fired from that movie theater for going in and watching movies rather than actually working in the movie theater. And the movie that I got caught watching over and over again the day that I got fired was Return of the Living Dead. It was a very influential film for me. So I wanted to bring my A game.
I tried to get people who really wanted to do it, who were enthusiastic about doing it.
I was actually working in San Diego, and I was told that I needed to be up there for the one last audition with all the executives, the producers, and the director at 3 p.m. that day. Well, I was shooting in San Diego. I couldn't make it. So my agent said, well, when can you be there by? I can be there by midnight back in Los Angeles. And I go, I know they're never gonna do that, so see what you can do for me. She called me back up and she said, they'll meet you there at midnight at the production office. So I got in my car when I got off the set, and I made it to Los Angeles just a few minutes early, and got myself together, gave the audition of my life, got back in the car, drove back down to San Diego, was on set again by 7 a.m. And I was told the fact that I went through all of that to get to the final callback is a big reason why I got the part.
With the leading man cast quite literally in the midnight hour, director Brian Yuzna now faced another challenge, finding an actress who not only would, but could effectively portray the role of Kurt's undead lover, Julie.
I think the one, of course, that was the most difficult was Julie, because she had to, in a way, carry the movie, and she had a very difficult thing. She had to be this sort of rebellious girl, kind of goth girl, and then she had to slowly become a zombie and deal with it in a psychological way.
And it was tough because the person had to be a really, really good actress to play that sort of. It was more than there was a real interior craving for brains that she was going through, and the different stages of breakdown and the desperation. So we always knew that we really wanted a strong actress. And when Mindy Clark came in, she was phenomenal, really, really terrific.
Mindy was awesome. I couldn't have asked for a better and more professional co-star.
With the leads locked in, it was time to find the supporting roles, and the production used a variety of ways to select the perfect talent.
We, you know, tried to get, you know, people who would be, have some recognition factor. So that would be Sarah Douglas and Kent McCord.
Generally, I don't write with actors in mind. The only exception was that the part that Kent McCord played, which was Kurt's dad, that was written as a great Santini type.
He didn't send in his headshot. We asked him to come in and talk to us.
I grew up watching Ken on Adam 12, as probably most of us did, and he was a really cool guy.
Sarah Douglas came in through discussions with Trimark. She was great, of course, and she was really something on the set. She liked to give people a hard time, I mean in a good way, but she was really funny. And she came in and she was very enthusiastic.
I got involved in Return of the Living Dead Part 3, actually, I believe through John Penny.
I thought, well, geez, you know, we really should have somebody from the first two in this third one, and we should do that in some way very cool, and it ended up, I brought Brian the idea.
And being the complete and total show business whore that I am, I said, of course I will be in Part 3, and you don't even have to pay me. I met with Brian Yuzna. He basically just said, are you willing to do a part of this? I said, absolutely. They're like, great, you're the ballistics technician. And I said, sign me up.
At the beginning, we were going to put Don Calfa and James Caron in the movie. and not playing the parts they played in the previous movies, but in new parts.
I had heard at the time that the part played by, his name is James Callahan, he played the Colonel. And I was told that some of the original cast members had been offered that role, and they weren't able to do it.
Evidently, their scheduling didn't work out, and so we did have the good fortune of getting Brian Peck in it. So at least we got one guy who had the juice from the other two movies.
It worked out terrific, and it was great to have him be the one guy who's in all three.
With the casting roller coaster finally complete, production began on October 22, 1992, beginning with a scene that was elaborate, gruesome, and for many of the cast and crew, incredibly memorable.
We shot out here in Santa Clarita. That's where we built the sets. And we had some locations downtown. We went down to the 7th Street Bridge, down in the LA River, around the, you know, the warehouse district downtown.
The sequence I was involved in Return of the Living Dead 3 was in this military installation where they're testing this freeze bullet gun system as a way to incapacitate the living dead. And the thing I remember most about the scene is there was a gentleman by the name of Clarence Epperson, and he portrayed the zombie in that sequence.
Clarence was a homeless guy living at the LA airport, and Brian found him and we brought him in, but he had such an amazing look that there was not a whole lot we needed to do with makeup.
I mean, they had just, you know, kind of made him pale and zombie-like, and he had this bizarre little kind of like leather thong contraption. And as you recall in the movie, you know, we hoist him up, and for some odd reason, the little thong contraption that covered his junk would not stay secured closed. So inevitably, every time we would hoist his arms and sort of secure him, right at that moment is when the flap of his little thong would fall open. And needless to say, Clarence's delicates would spill out.
Brian gets ready to call action and notices that his cock has slipped out of the diaper area. So there's a homeless man's cock, just nasty, uncircumcised, homeless cock.
And we would all recoil in horror. That was the real horror part of that scene.
Well, that's pretty funny, actually.
Clarence didn't seem to mind. I mean, he seemed fine with it, but it was a bit disturbing.
All I remember is, boy, we started working on that movie. I was totally consumed with making that movie, and it seems like you're kind of on a... You know, the train had left the station and you were barreling down the track.
I just thought, how in the name of our creator are all of these effects going to get done, not only on time, but on budget, because clearly it's a lower budget film. And Brian had a great answer for that. A single effects house, makeup effects house, can't possibly handle it all. We'll split it up between several effects houses.
Brian really did a brilliant thing by hiring these different teams of special effects people. And he brought them in, and they all were to do different elements.
Steve was a very dynamic person, a very talented person, very good at what he does. And he brought all these cool dummies, mummies, and casts and whatnot to the set.
I was really pleased that he awarded me the Julie contract because she's the star of the film. The process in designing that was really simple. Brian designed it.
Oh, the piercing of Julie when she puts all the metal in her in the glass.
The whole idea of Julie and the piercing is really interesting. I think Brian really thought of this concept early on.
I mean, we clearly came up with the mechanical aspects of how to create this thing, which was basically a full body prosthetic. I mean, every piece of exposed skin on her is a prosthetic.
The way I looked at that piercing was a desperate attempt to feel something. In other words, the piercing was a way that she could, you know, feel alive on some level.
What Julie is a cutter. She's a zombie cutter, and she'll go to any length, causing herself pain to stop causing other people pain. And it really is the mentality behind actual cutters. I thought that was a very interesting statement on the screenwriter's part.
We just felt like we were off doing our own thing, and we didn't have really any sort of, you know, restrictions put on us in terms of the amount of gore and what kind of movie we were doing. It was really wonderful.
I actually sat in the room with her the very first day when she was getting it applied. I didn't want to feel too shocked when I was in front of the camera.
When she first shows up, she's lit from the top, very starkly, like Boris Karloff when he first appears behind the door in Bride of Frankenstein. Absolutely archetypal image. And it's a full body shot, and she's got these shards of glass coming out of her. Clothes are ripped, very gothic, very modern, new age now, but before its time.
I thought she looked cool. It was, how do you say this, kind of horrific sexy.
And while the film made sure to play up Julie's sex appeal, actor Trevor Edmonds soon found he would be brought into the act for a steamier than expected love scene.
The amount of nudity in the film, my feelings about that, Mindy was somewhat comfortable with herself. I was a little bit more self-conscious. Brian actually cornered me in my dressing room right before that scene and said that he wanted me to be 100% naked and wanted me to frame my butt in the shot. And my mom immediately kind of popped into my mind, and she always said, do whatever you want in front of the camera until they tell you to take your clothes off. And I told him, I go, Brian, I go, I'd do it, but my mom would kill me. I'm sorry, I just can't do it. And that was that. I was pretty comfortable with what they shot, though.
There was, however, one aspect of filming the actor did find less than comfortable.
The day that we shot the scene at the old Marine Land in Palos Verdes, where Julie falls off the motorcycle and breaks her neck. That scene was a crying scene. And as any good makeup person does, they have a little straw with menthol in it that they are ready to blow in an actor's eyes if his tears aren't coming the way that they're supposed to. And this particular makeup person wanted to test the menthol blower on my eyes to see how it would work, and did not have the capsule on the end of it, and blew the menthol rocks right into my eyes. And that was probably one of the worst and most painful experiences I've ever had. And after 2 hours of flushing my eyes out and having the emergency team look at me, Brian grabs me and he goes, perfect, it looks like you've been crying. Let's shoot it.
You know, Brian was a really, really great director. Again, Brian, you know, understands that when you work with a team, the way to bring out the best in people is to let them do their best and not to micromanage.
He had a very, very strong concept of what he wanted in that film and what he wanted from my character. And I was very impressed with the picture he painted for me.
A cast and crew pleased with their work and their director saw the film released on Halloween weekend, 1993. However, hopes for a zombie hit were dashed when the film garnered less than spectacular fanfare from critics and audiences alike.
People either loved it or they hated it. People that expected the camp that was in the first two installments of the Return series were sorely disappointed with the third. People that took it on its own merit and said, okay, part three is going to be a different take on this and let it be a different film are usually the fans of the film.
I actually really liked Return of the Living Dead 3 almost a little more than Return of the Living Dead 2, even though I wasn't involved as much, because I again appreciated that it was a little grittier, a little grosser, and scarier, which, when all things are said and done, I sort of prefer.
The movie worked great for me. I was really happy with it, and Trimark was really happy with it, and we took it to Cannes and we screened it, and the buyers loved it. It went over really well.
We tried to do something different. Some people liked it, some people didn't. I personally liked it myself, and I'm very proud to have been part of Return of the Living Dead 3.
Again, I have to keep going back to Brian. I mean, how interesting to make a Shakespearean love story zombie movie.
I just am thrilled that I got to be a part of these movies and a part of this franchise. And the fact that these films, particularly the first one, have achieved such a cult following has re-energized and sort of reinvigorated my passion for the franchise.
Such an amazing experience that I'll always have a certain place in my heart for that experience. It was great. It's, to this day, I kind of hold it up there as one of my favorite times.
If this was the last thing I had to say about Return of the Living Dead, the series, I'd say, watch the movies. They're great.
And to this day, it lives on. And to all the fans out there, I thank you for watching and appreciating what we tried to do.
I think that's fine, I think. Yeah.